Hi guys, it's me, Professor Dean, and welcome back to my YouTube channel. On this video, I'm going to be going over cognitive disorders, but to be more specific, I'm going to be covering Alzheimer's disease. Now, before we get started, as always, I'm going to ask you to please support me and support this channel by liking this video. You're going to love it. So go ahead and press that thumbs up button now. Subscribe to my channel if you haven't done so already. And don't forget, I'm now offering next generation NCLEX reviews, one-on-one tutoring sessions, and consultation sessions. Also, I have audio lessons available for you to check out by going to my website, nexusnursinginstitute.com. Almost daily, you can find me covering a variety of nursing topics on my other social media platforms, such as TikTok, Instagram, and Facebook, so be sure to check me out there. Now, before we get started, I want to start off with a prayer. If you're not into that, guys, just go ahead and press that fast forward button. That's all you got to do. As soon as you see me open my eyes, that means I'm done. You can get started, okay? All right, close your eyes, bow your head if you want prayer. Father God, thank you, Lord, for all that you've done. Thank you for waking us up this morning. Thank you for the breath of life in our bodies, Lord. Thank you for this opportunity that we have yet again to go over information, Lord. I ask that you please help every single viewer, listener, right now, Father God, help them to be able to focus. I ask that you remove all distractions, Lord, so they can focus on this information and get out of it what they need to get out of it, Father God. I pray that you please help them when they see these same concepts and principles again, that they can be able to apply them correctly, Father God, and be able to think critically and answer the questions correctly. Thank you, Father God, for all that you've done for us and all that you'll continue to do. In Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. All right, guys, let's get started. First question. The client in the early stage of Alzheimer's disease and his adult son attend appointment at the community mental health center. While conversing with the nurse, the son states, "I'm tired of hearing about things that were 30 years ago. Why does dad always talk about the past?" The nurse should tell the son, one, your dad lost his short-term memory, but he still has long-term memory. Two, you need to be more accepting of your dad's behavior. Three, I want you to understand your dad's level of anxiety. Four, telling your dad that you're tired of hearing about the past will help him to stop. And guys, the correct answer is one, and this is what happens in Alzheimer's. Your dad lost his short-term memory, but he still has his long-term memory. So the patient forgetting what happened a couple hours ago or yesterday, but remembering what happened 30 years ago, we see this in the early stages of Alzheimer's. Now, as this disease progresses, because remember, this is a cognitive deficient disorder, as the disease progresses, eventually the patient will go into the terminal stage where they'll even forget things that were 30 years ago. They'll have water in front of them and not realize that the water's for drinking. Remember, this is a progressive disorder. But in the early stage, such as this question, they'll still remember things that were from a long time ago, but they'll just forget very recent events. That's why number one's the correct answer. Now, let's look at the wrong answer choices. Two, you need to be more. Stop right there. You need to be. We don't judge. We don't give advice. You don't do that in nursing. So we know that's wrong. Choice three, I want you to understand your dad's level of anxiety. This is a cognitive disorder, not an anxiety disorder. And then choice four, telling your dad that you're tired of hearing about the past will help him stop. That's false. It's just not true. It's not going to help them to stop. So number one is the correct answer choice. When developing the plan of care for a client with Alzheimer's disease who's experiencing moderate impairment, which of the following types of care should the nurse expect to include? One, prompting and guiding activities of daily living. Two, managing medication schedule. Three, constant supervision and total care. Four, supervision of risky activities such as shaving. What do you guys think? Okay, guys, and the correct answer is going to be one, prompting and guiding activities of daily living. So if you go back to the question, it says the patient has moderate impairment. So what happens is with moderate impairment, they can no longer make decisions for themselves, but they can follow directions. This is what's going on with this type of patient. So that's why one's the correct answer, to prompt and give directions. Even though they can't make decisions, they can still follow directions when it comes to moderate level, okay? Now let's look at the wrong answer choices. Two, managing a medication schedule. Remember, this patient has moderate impairment. Guess what? Managing the patient's medical schedule, you would need to do that even with mild, M-I-L-D, impairment. Because with mild impairment, that patient could still have forgotten that they took their medication an hour ago, right? So for choice number two, that's wrong. Then look at choice number three, constant supervision, total care. That's for what? That patient that's at the terminal stage. This disorder, this disease has progressed to the point that the patient needs total care. Because remember, again, this is a progressive disease. That means as time goes on, it only gets worse. And then choice four, supervision of risky activities such as shaving, that would be for a patient with mild impairment. And again, this question is talking about moderate impairment. In moderate impairment, the patient can't make decisions, but they can still follow directions. That's why number one is the correct answer choice. The family of a client diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease wants to keep the client at home. They say they have the most difficulty in managing his wandering. The nurse should instruct the family to do which of the following, select all that apply. Guys, how do we treat select all that apply? We treat them as true or false. One, ask the physician for a sleeping medication. False. Giving that patient sleeping pills just to make them not wander, guess what? That's a form of chemical restraints. That's absolutely false. Two, instill motion and sound detectors. That's appropriate intervention, true. Three, have a relative sit with the client all night. False. That's unrealistic. What is the one word in that answer choice, that option that made you know it would have been false anyway? That word all, right? We stay away from all inclusives. We stay away from all, always, none, never. Anything that's all inclusive most likely is not going to be your correct answer choice. Four, have the client wear a medic alert bracelet. True, that is a very appropriate intervention. Five, install door alarms and high door locks. True. Why high door locks? Because if it's lower, the patient can be able to reach it and they can look over your shoulder, see what the code was and get out. So choices number two, four, and five, all of those are appropriate interventions. Not so much choices number one and three, and I already explained the reason why. Which of the following is a priority to include in the plan of care for a client with Alzheimer's disease who's experiencing difficulty processing and completing complex tasks? One, repeating the directions until the client follows them. Two, asking the client to do one step of the task at a time. Three, demonstrating for the client how to do the task. Four, maintaining routine and structure for the client. And the correct answer is two, asking the client to do one step of the task at a time. So when it comes to these type of patients, you kind of treat them like a toddler. And I don't mean to be disrespectful when I say that. I mean, think about what you learned in peds and with a pediatric patient when it's a toddler and they're getting into something that they shouldn't get into. You don't tell them not to do that. What do? You distract them. That's the same thing you do with this type of patient. With the toddler, you cannot give complex tasks. You can't say, okay, I want you to pick up the shoe, bring it over here, then tie the shoe, then bring it back to me. No, you have to give them one step at a time. Same thing with this type of patient. So that's why number two is the correct answer. You don't want to overwhelm them. Choice one, repeating the directions until the client follows them. You can repeat the directions a million times. It's too overwhelming. You have to give the directions one step at a time. Give them the direction, let them complete it, then tell them what to do that next. Let them complete that, and then you move on. Choice three, demonstrating for the client how to do the task. Still, it's many steps, and if you don't break it down, it's still going to be too overwhelming for them. So that's false. And then choice four, maintaining routine and structure for the client. This is a great thing to do for patients with Alzheimer's disease, patients with cognitive deficits. This is a wonderful thing to do to maintain a routine structure, right? Here's the thing. What does routine structure have to do with them processing complex tasks? And this is what NCLEX will do to you. Or maybe you're taking a HESI or an ATI or an exit exam, or maybe you're just taking a nursing exam. Let me tell you something. You will see a beautiful answer choice, but that beautiful answer choice must be the correct answer for your question. If it doesn't answer your question, as beautiful as it is, you need to get rid of it and choose the next best option. So that's why number two is correct for this one. The client with Alzheimer's disease may have delusions about being harmed by staff and others. When the client expresses fear of being killed by staff, which of the following responses is most appropriate? One, what makes you think we want to kill you? Two, we like you too much to want to kill you. Three, you're in the hospital. We are nurses trying to help you. Or four, oh, don't be silly. No one wants to kill you here. And the correct answer is three. You're in the hospital. We are nurses trying to help you. So you're going to do what? Reorient the patient. Reorient that patient and bring them back to reality. That is the correct answer. You never want to be judgmental. You never want to criticize the patient. Let's look at the wrong answer choices. One, what makes you think? Stop. Therapeutic communication never starts with what made you or why. Why did you do this? Never. Okay, so we're going to get rid of that. Choice two, we like you too much to want to kill you. So if we didn't like you, we'd want to kill you. Is that the message you want to be sending to the patient? Absolutely not. False. And then choice four, oh, don't be silly. Now, you know that's therapy. That's non-therapeutic communication. You never call a patient silly. So the only correct answer choice is number three, where you're reorienting your patient back to reality. When helping the families of clients with Alzheimer's disease cope with vulgar or sexual behaviors, which of the following suggestions is most helpful? One, ignore the behaviors, but try to identify the underlying need for the behaviors. Two, give feedback on the inappropriateness of the behaviors. Three, employ anger management strategies. Or four, administer the prescribed risperidone risperdal. And guys, the correct answer is number one. Just like when a toddler is acting out, you ignore that tantrum, you ignore that outburst, but you want to get to the source of the issue. And for this type of patient, when we see these type of behaviors, usually the source is anger. They're angry about something. So you want to get to the source and pay attention to the source and not so much the behavior. Okay, so number one's the correct answer. Let's look at the wrong answer choices. Two, give feedback on the inappropriateness of the cognitive behavior. Guess what? They're not going to care. They're not going to care. Remember, their cognition is impaired. What is cognition? How someone thinks. It's not their fault. Choice three, employ anger management strategies. No, the first thing you want to do is identify the source and then help correct the source. This is a patient with cognitive impairment. Do you really think that they're going to recognize when they get angry and then start implementing these anger management strategies? No. Choice four, administer the prescribed risperidone. This will help decrease the patient's agitation, but it really doesn't get down to the source of the behavior. Like I said, the source of behavior is usually, you know, anger or maybe sensual needs. But the point is, it may decrease that agitation, that restlessness, but it's really not getting to the source of that behavior. And that's really what we want to address. And that's why number one is the correct answer choice. The nurse determines that the son of a client with Alzheimer's disease needs further education about the disease when he makes which of the following statements? One, I didn't realize the deterioration would be so incapacitating. Two, the Alzheimer's support group has so much good information. Three, I get tired of the same old stories, but I know it's important for Dad. Four, I woke up this morning expecting that my old dad would be back. And guys, the correct answer is four. There's no turning back time. There's no cure for this disease. This disease is progressive. And that means as time goes on, it only gets worse. That patient will get to a point where they're going to be total care. Okay, so number four is the correct answer because number one, two, and three all show that the patient, that the son understands this disorder. The husband of a client with Alzheimer's disease was diagnosed 6 years ago, approaches the nurse and says, I'm so excited that my wife is starting to use Aricept for her illness. The nurse should tell the husband, one, the medication's effective mostly in the early stages of the illness. Two, the adverse effects of the drug are numerous. Three, the client will attain a functional level of that 6 years ago. 4, effectiveness of the terminal phase of the illness is scientifically proven. Okay, guys, so donepezil, that medication, Aricept, this is a medication that's most effective in the early stages, and that's why number 1 is the correct answer. Let's look at the wrong choices. 2, the adverse effects of the drug are numerous. Actually, they're few compared to other drugs in the same class, this type of medication. They're actually fewer, so that's false. Choice 3, the client will attain functional level of that 6 years ago. There's no going back. This disorder is progressive. That means as time goes on, it's only gonna get worse. Choice 4, effectiveness in the terminal phase of the illness is scientifically proven. Again, no, this medication is most effective in the early stages. And if you go back to the question, patient was diagnosed what? 6 years ago. So number 1 is the correct answer choice. The physician orders risperidone and risperdal for a client with Alzheimer's disease. The nurse anticipates administering this medication to help decrease which of the following behaviors? 1, sleep disturbances. 2, concomitant depression. 3, agitation and assaultiveness. Or 4, confusion and withdrawal. What do you think the indication would be to give risperidone? Okay, guys, so risperidone, also known as risperidone, this is an antipsychotic medication. And so the correct answer is going to be 3, agitation and assaultiveness. The nurse is making a home visit with a client diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease. The client was recently started on lorazepam, Ativan, due to increased anxiety. The nurse is cautioning the family about the use of lorazepam, also known as Ativan. The nurse should instruct the family to report which of the following significant side effects to the healthcare provider. 1, paradoxical excitement. 2, headache. 3, slowing of reflexes. Or 4, fatigue. And guys, the correct answer is 1, paradoxical excitement. So let's talk about this. First of all, lorazepam is a benzodiazepine. And you see choices 2, 3, and 4. All of these are side effects that may happen when the patient takes the medication. You're going to warn them that it can possibly happen. We're not going to stop the medication if it happens. We're just going to give them a heads up so they don't stop taking the medication. It's a side effect, right? But you see choice number 1, that is an adverse effect. That is something that may possibly happen. We warn them may possibly happen, and we tell them if it happens, let us know right away, because most likely the healthcare provider is either going to change the medication, change the dosage. They will adjunct it in some type of way, right? So that's number 1, paradoxical excitement. Now, what is paradoxical? What does that mean? That means opposite. So paradoxical excitement, that's an adverse effect because that is an opposite effect of what we expect to happen, what we would like to see happen, okay? So number 1 is the correct answer choice. When providing family education for those who have a relative with Alzheimer's disease about minimizing stress, which of the following suggestions is most relevant? 1, allow the client to go to bed 4 to 5 times during the day. 2, test the cognitive functionings of the client several times a day. 3, provide reality orientation even if memory loss is severe. 4, maintain consistency in environment, routine, and caregivers. And guys, the correct answer is 4. Maintain consistency in the environment, their routine, and their caregivers. Why? Change increases stress, just like with toddlers. Have you ever gone to a daycare? You will see that they have routine. They're going to be at the same place at the same time. So lunch is going to be at the same time. Nap time is always going to be at the same time. Recess is always going to be at the same time. They strive on having routine because change is stressful to them. Let's look at the wrong answer choices. 1, allow the client to go to bed 4 to 5 times during the day, but you expect them to sleep at night. What kind of sense does that make? No, during the day, we want them to have activities that stimulate their mind. During the day, we want them to socialize with peers. So that's false. Choice 2, test the cognitive functioning of the client several times a day. That is annoying. Would you want to be tested several times a day? No, false. Choice 3, provide reality orientation even if the memory loss is severe. if the memory loss is severe, why would you provide reality orientation? Memory loss is severe, okay? Not mild, not moderate, severe. You gotta use your resources efficiently. So the only correct answer choice here, guys, is number 4, maintaining the consistency of the environment, routine, and caregivers. And something else, guys, remember that with this question, the question is all about decreasing the patient's stress. That patient, this last choice, that patient that has severe memory loss, you keep trying to reorient them. Don't you think that's actually going to increase their stress level? Absolutely. A client reports having blurred vision after 4 days of taking haloperidol, Haldol 1 milligrams twice a day, and benztropine cogentin 2 milligrams twice a day. The nurse contacts the physician to explain the situation, background, assessment, and make a recommendation. Which information reported to the physician is assessment of the situation? 1, Mr. Roberts is taking 1 milligrams of Haldol twice a day and cogentin 2 milligrams twice a day. 2, I think Mr. Roberts might need a lower dose of cogentin. 3, Mr. Roberts reports having blurred vision since this morning. 4, the higher dose of cogentin could be causing Mr. Roberts blurred vision. And the correct answer is number 4. Why? Number 4 is showing that you understand what's happening here. Go back to the question. What the question says is which information reported to the physician is an assessment of the situation. In other words, assessment of understanding of the problem. Which answer shows that you understand the problem? You understand what's happening here. And it's 4. The higher dose of cogentin, by the way, cogentin is an anticholinergic. Don't forget that poem I taught you for anticholinergics. Can't see, can't spit, can't pee, can't, right? Can't see, blurred vision, can't spit, dry mouth, can't pee, urinary retention, can't constipation. So we understand the anticholinergics can cause blurred vision. So that high dose of the anticholinergic can be what's causing the blurred vision. Look at number 4. The higher dose of cogentin and anticholinergic could be the cause of Mr. Roberts' blurred vision. Now let's look at the wrong answer choices. 1, Mr. Roberts is taking 1 milligrams of Haldol twice a day and cogentin 2 milligrams twice a day. That is true, but it doesn't show that you understand what's happening. Choice number 2, I think Mr. Roberts might need a lower dose of cogentin. That is true, but it does not show that you understand what is happening. Choice number 3, Mr. Roberts reports having blurred vision since this morning. That is true, but it does not show that you understand what is happening. But choice number 4 does. When assessing an aggressive client, which of the following behaviors warrants the nurse's prompt reporting and use of safety precautions? 1, crying when talking about his divorce. 2, starting a petition to delay bedtime. 3, declining attendance at a daily group therapy session. Or 4, naming another client as his adversary. I said that wrong. As his adversary. I'm sorry, guys, if you're new to my channel, I have a speech impediment. I was born with it, never went away, so please excuse me. I mispronounce lots of things, and it might take me a minute to say it correctly. I'm trying my best, though. Okay, so anyway, guys, the correct answer is 4, naming another client as his adversary. Naming someone else as their enemy, as their next victim, as their next target, you better watch out. Choice number 4, that is a safety issue. Choices number 1, 2, and 3, those don't pose any safety risk like choice number 4 does. Choice number 4 shows a safety risk. That patient has pointed somebody else out that is the enemy, the adversary. All right, guys, we are down to our last question. A nurse is planning care for an elderly client with cognitive impairment who's still living at home. Which action should the nurse identify as a priority for safety in planning care for this client? 1, having 2 people accompany the client whenever the client is up and about. 2, ensuring the removal of objects in the client's path that may cause him to trip. 3, putting the client's favorite belongings in a safe place so that he will not lose them. Or 4, giving the client his medications in liquid form to make certain that he swallows them. And guys, the correct answer is 2, ensuring removal of objects in the client's path that may cause him to trip. Remember, this question is asking about safety. Protecting them from falling is addressing safety. Now let's look at the wrong answer choices. 1, having 2 people accompany the client whenever the client is up and about. That is not realistic. Choice 3, putting the client's favorite belongings in a safe place so they don't lose them. That has nothing to do with safety. Choice 4, giving the client his medications in liquid form to make sure he swallows them. That's more about compliance, not about safety. This question was about safety, and that's why number 2 is the correct answer choice. And guys, that's the end of this video. Please sound off in the comment section. Let me know what you thought about this video. Let me know if you'd like me to teach more about Alzheimer's disease and in what format, a Q&A format like this, or maybe you want it in a Kahoot format or even a lesson format where I'm teaching out of a book. Let me know in the comment section. Don't forget, almost daily, you can find me covering a variety of nursing topics on my other social media platforms such as TikTok, Instagram, and Facebook. So be sure to check out my other platforms. My handle is the same everywhere, Nexus Nursing. And also, go ahead and book your one-on-one tutoring session, consultation session, or next generation NCLEX review class by going to my website, nexusnursinginstitute.com. While you're there, be sure to check out the audio lessons that I have available. Guys, thank you for watching the video, and you guys catch me on the next video.